Honorable Board of Trustees of the Shiv Nadar University, Shiv, the great founder himself, the Chancellor, Professor Balakrishnan, Vice Chancellor Sinha, President Swaroop, my distinguished colleagues, distinguished members of the audience, proud parents, and above all, the 295 plus or minus one or two graduating students. I don't know the exact number, actually. This is truly a great and exciting day because, you know, you represent the first batch of a budding and unique institution. But I think I would say this is more than just a budding institution. It's actually a remarkable experiment in the history of, you know, Indian education. I'm going to come to that in a second. It actually turns out that it's a very appropriate thing to be discussing today, because we have in our midst the first chancellor who may actually be rewriting education policy in India for the next 20, 30 years, Dr. T.S.R. Subramanian. So it's great to be here. Because it is such a, you know, unique and special day, for me it's a real honor to be here to present this first convocation speech. And to be honest with you, it's a real responsibility. And I'm not joking when I say that I spent all of yesterday and many days before. And in fact, you know, I drove up in the car, 2 hours in the car. I was in front of my computer in the car actually preparing, because it's a very nervous thing for me, you know, what should I say? But then I thought back and I said, you know, when I attended my graduation, what did the person say? And I have no clue. Actually, I don't even know who the person was who gave that speech. So it's a very liberating thought that, you know, at worst, I'll be forgotten by all of you, which is no bad thing, because, you know, all of you are going to go on to do great things. But, you know, in some ways, it's not an easy thing to do, to try and actually, you know, try and give you advice. You know, either you have to be a preacher, or you have to be as energized as Professor Balakrishnan to, you know, give the kind of rah-rah motivational speech for this university. And, you know, I'm not very good at that. Actually, there's a great novel called The Leopard by an Italian. And he basically says, you know, the more advice you give, the more it's true that you've deceived yourself. So self-deception is a prerequisite for giving advice. So the more advice I give you, the more you know I've deceived myself, and the less you should pay heed to what I say. So just bear with me. Now, it turns out that when thinking about what I should speak, I went about it the following way. Shiv Nadar University was so kind and gracious that it sent two sets of people to invite me. Not because I had to be persuaded, because I said first no the first time, and then therefore a second batch had to come, but just I think your grace and graciousness and hospitality. So when the first set of people came, the inviters came, I asked them what I should speak on, and I think actually Professor Gangopadhyay said you have to speak on higher education in India. Then when the second set of speakers came, they said, of course, you have to give a convocation speech that will appeal to the students. So what I've decided to do is to spend my time speaking a little bit about both about higher education, but also about, you know, trying to do a Professor Balakrishnan and give you a kind of motivational speech. So first, about higher education in India and why this Shiv Nadar experiment is so special and so unique. You know, I'm a kind of boring economist, you know, but it's one trait of boring economists that they always like to post choices: growth or development, equity or efficiency, markets or government. And in this context, it's is it better to do basic education or higher education? And as with most things that economists say, these are completely false choices. It's completely wrong because you have to do everything. It's true, of course, that our early leaders made some, you know, looking back, it seems like somewhat inadequate choices by not developing, giving enough attention and resources to primary and basic education in India. That's why I think our record on education is actually not very, on basic education is not strong, and it's still a challenge. But I think one of the things that we did get, and this goes back, of course, to before independence, is that we have inherited, you know, or we did inherit a system of good higher education. Now, when you step back and think about it, when you ask yourself, why is education important for a country? And, you know, people will give different answers. And I would like to give three reasons why I think education is important. I think that, you know, it's something that I think either the Chancellor or the Vice Chancellor said, that, you know, the legacy of financial and human capital that, you know, Shiv Nadar is going to kind of give to the country. But I think there's something even more and deeper than that, which I think is the value of education, which is kind of, you know, the intellectual capital that, you know, education represents. Now, this intellectual capital is very, very important for a number of reasons. You know, I think it's what shapes and determines our democracy, the kind of arguments we have, the kind of discourse we have, the kind of debates we have. All of this requires education and an educated elite. And in fact, if you think about it, it was because of our education that, you know, our independence leaders were able to question and hold up the mirror to our colonial masters to say, you know, you talk about British ideals of liberty and justice, but you don't actually practice it in the colonies. So, you know, this kind of intellectual kind of standing up that, you know, as a country we need to have, this talk of intellectual capital can only come with education. From my own field, let me give you an example that, you know, there are lots of debates about, you know, should a country allow foreign capital? Should we embrace capitalism? But these are all debates that pretty much are shaped outside our country. And, you know, if you don't have the intellectual capital, we will not be able to engage in these debates for ourselves, you know, with the kind of maturity, reason, moderation, judgment that we need to bring upon this. So I think the first value of education, I think, is wonderfully summed up in this great quote due to Mahatma Gandhi, when he said that, "I want the culture of all lands to be blown about my house as freely as possible, but I will not be blown off my feet by any of these." So essentially, to be able to do that, we need education. And, you know, let it be said, if it's a little bit politically incorrect, we need education, we need educated elites to have this intellectual capital for a country. So that, I think, is I think, a very important aspect of higher education, of which, of course, you're going to be a part of. The second thing, of course, is the most obvious one, more obvious one, is that if you look at India today as an economist, the fact that we've become a service-led economy, an IT powerhouse, a knowledge economy, a large part of that is because of the wonderful institutions of higher education that India has had. And of course, we've produced iconic companies, IT companies like HCL, Infosys, you know, Wipro, and so on. And now if you see, you know, Google wants to come, you know, Amazon wants to come, Mark Zuckerberg was here, Facebook. And all of this, I think, would not have been possible had we not had a great system of higher education. I think the third big value of education today I see in India is that it has become a symbol of aspiration for India. Higher education is, I think, the ultimate aspiration for all middle-class Indians. And if you think about it, even some of the protests and, you know, the social discontent and disaffection that we see reflects this kind of frustration at not being able to achieve this aspiration of getting higher, getting access to higher education. So I think, you know, intellectual capital, the knowledge economy, the symbol of aspiration for all three, higher education is very important. And Shiv Nadar, of course, is in the forefront of that. But even from a kind of more narrow economic point of view going forward for me as an economist, if you think about it, you know, the last 10 or 20 years, India has grown very rapidly, in part because, you know, our IT sector has boomed, our services sector has boomed. And, you know, these sectors have slowed down considerably in the last 4 or 5 years. So if India is to maintain its growth momentum, it has to be a powerhouse once again of exporting IT services and all kinds of services. And if that has to happen, we have to be producing more and more graduates like you. We need not one, not two, but thousands and thousands of Shiv Nadar universities in order to make India the global powerhouse that India deserves to be. Now, of course, I say all of this and to highlight, you know, this is not, I'm not an expert on education, but many people have observed that, you know, over time, you know, some of India's, am I doing something wrong? No. I worry, I thought there was, I was going to be told that the mic was too high or too low. There is this, you know, many people have observed that, you know, something has not been right with the state of higher education for some considerable period of time. And of course, one of the challenges for this government is to try and retrieve it. And of course, to repeat my point, it couldn't be in better hands than with Dr. T.S.R. Subramanian. See, I'm not an expert on higher education, but I know these issues relating to centralization, bureaucratization, standardization, you know, completely neutering academic freedom and flexibility, polarization of ideologies, incompetence in running institutions. All these have been offered as problems in the Indian higher education sector. I have no solutions to offer, and you know, I don't know enough about this to say. But what I can say is that given this decline, you know, which has been in train for a long time, it is precisely for that reason why Shiv Nadar University, what I said, is such a remarkable and important experiment. I am fully aware of the difficulties, you know, or probably I can't even imagine the difficulties that must have been, you and the founders must have encountered in setting this up. Shiv, for example, was saying that between the idea and getting this, it took you 6 years. I mean, and that probably is very fast by Indian standards, you know. So I dread to think what other education entrepreneurs go through. But I think, you know, given the difficulties, given the bureaucracy, given the challenges that I said, I think it's a remarkable experiment. It's also a remarkable experiment that it's in the private sector. It's private sector led. It's also a remarkable experiment because in India, even as higher education institutions have declined, it has been less difficult to set up institutions of management or medical colleges or engineering degrees. That's relatively easy to do. It's been very, very, very difficult to set up, you know, a university like this, which has liberal arts, humanities, and the sciences, and research, and put it all together like you've had. And so that makes it even more remarkable. And I think, finally, something that I'm really astonished by, and I think which is one of the greatest challenges of setting up world-class institutions like Shiv Nadar, is that the market for teaching talent is now global. So you cannot attract top quality to talent, or the pool cannot be restricted to any one country alone. So to be able to do this in such a challenging environment is why I know I bow my head and take my hats off to all of you who've made this such a remarkable success. So all power to you and to you students. But you know, a small piece of gratuitous advice. just as I have enlisted the challenges of the public sector, you know, the bureaucratization, the centralization, the lack of freedom, please be careful that, you know, you don't start imitating the worst sins of the very government institutions that you're trying to, you know, move away from. So that's just a cautionary piece of advice. Now, the final reason why I think this is, you know, very important is that, you know, having said that, you know, the public system of public institutions in education have been relatively weak and we need a private sector. But I think we should not forget that India needs very, very strong public institutions in higher education to provide the backbone for the system in India. So the advantage of having institutions like Shiv Nadar and others like Ashoka and Jindal and the Premji Foundation is that you put pressure on, healthy competitive pressure on, the public institutions to resolve. Maybe it was not a coincidence that the appointment of TSR was because of the convocation of Shiv Nadar University in order to put pressure on the public system to reform. So in that sense, it's a wonderful thing. Now to the second part of my lecture, which is going to be the slightly more difficult and, you know, more boring part of the lecture, is going to be addressed to you students. I think just the fact that you are here at this very special institution means that you are very special, you've done a great job, you've earned this, and you deserve to be here. And you know, I was just thinking you probably would be the top 0.01% of your cohort of you know kids in India today. So you belong to a very, 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 you know, very, very special class of people. But that also means that you're highly privileged. So you have to do a lot of things like, you know, as they've said, working hard and so on. I just hope that you've worked as hard to leave the place as you worked hard to get here. I'm sure that's true. But because you're highly privileged, I think it comes with certain responsibilities. Now, how should I express these responsibilities? So what I did was I went back and read some commencement speeches of the last, you know, 5-10 years. And I would urge all of you to go and read two of the very best. The one is by J.K. Rowling, the author of Harry Potter. She gave a commencement speech at Harvard University, I think 5 or 6 years ago. So hopefully when you go back, Google J.K. Rowling Harvard commencement speech, download, you know, zap it to each other or whatever it is. And the second commencement speech I would like you to read is a little bit more difficult, but I think, you know, maybe when you're sitting this evening with a glass of, no, I shouldn't say beer on your own, you should download this other one as well. It's by a great American novelist who died young, committed suicide. His name is David Foster Wallace, and this is a commencement speech that he gave in 2005 at Kenyon College in the United States. And what is remarkable is that both these have one very common theme. And I'm going to try and get the theme across to you. Bear with me, it's going to sound a little bit preachy, sermonizing, but just bear with me. After all, you have the choice to forget it after I leave. I think you quoted Chancellor John Weston about, you know, what education is about. It's not about, you know, filling a bucket, but, you know, lighting the fire. And that's absolutely true. But I think there is a sense in which education goes even beyond that. Especially a liberal arts education at a university like yours, which combines everything. Now, if you think about it, if you think about what is special about us humans, I think one, of course, we are, you know, thinking beings. The other is, I think, human beings have an awareness of the past and the future like no other living creature, and that's very important. But I think one very distinctive feature of us humans is that we can learn and understand without actually having experienced. So what J.K. Rowling and David Foster Wallace want us to think about as what an education should have is in fact the quality of imagination to be able to imagine the lives of others, of people other than ourselves. So when you come to a place like this, and you know, all of you are young, wanting to achieve, wanting to be successful, I mean, you will be told time and time again, imagine to think big, imagine to be bold, imagine to set up enterprises, imagine you're going to be scientists. And all of that is absolutely worth imagining, you should imagine. But I think you should also imagine what it is to live the lives of others or be in the shoes of others. Let me give you an example. Supposing you're driving from Delhi to Noida, as I did, the traffic is horrible and you're stuck in traffic. You can, in that traffic, you can kind of curse everyone, curse the world, you know, curse the cross that cuts, the car that cuts across and says, you know, and you can curse him as saying, selfish guy, he's coming in my way. And you can do all these things, or you can undertake a feat of imagination and put yourself and say, maybe those people in other cars have had very bad auto accidents, and now they find driving so terrifying that their therapist has actually, you know, encouraged them to buy big cars to feel safe. Or you can imagine that the man who cut across you is actually being driven by a father whose little child is hurt or sick in the seat next to him, and he's actually trying to get this kid to the hospital, and he's in a bigger and more legitimate hurry than you are. In fact, perhaps in that traffic, you are getting in his way. So this is the act of moral imagination that you have to do time and time and time again. Because remember, the world is what it is. All that you can change, the Bhagavad Gita says that all that you can change is your action. But I think in this postmodern, post-Freud world, what you have to think is that all the things that you can change and you can control is what you think inside this crazy head of ours. You know, the head is a demon. It's all these demons prowling around. You're thinking all kinds of thoughts. Maybe you're thinking now, why doesn't this guy shut up and, you know, let me get on with the convocation? You know, maybe you're thinking that, and you would be right to think so. But all that you control is in your head, and that's all we can. So you quoted Plutarch. There's another quote by Plutarch. Is what we achieve and think inwardly is what we, how we change outer reality. So by all means, you know, imagine in these bold and whatever ways, but also think about these kinds of things. Now, you know, have I lived by all that I've told you to do? You know, absolutely not, and I plead guilty. But of course, I have the benefit of a little bit of age, lots of mistakes, to try and urge you to not make the mistakes that I made. So, enough sermonizing, preaching. Let's come back. Today is your day, graduates. Of course, don't forget that you are here because a lot of people made that possible. So at this very moment, when you're thinking about your convocation, your degree, do exactly that act of moral imagination and put yourself in the shoes of all of those who've brought you here. Especially think now what your parents are thinking about you now. And, you know, I think you would be much happier and so, you know, savor the day, enjoy the sense of accomplishment, you know, enjoy the sense that you're on the verge of some big, you know, ambition, some great adventure that Shiv Nadar has made possible for you. But above all, given that you're privileged, do not forget to exercise the moral imagination of trying to live and inhabit the lives of others. Good luck and congratulations.